sulfide gas. You smell that around eggs. But in this case, that hydrogen sulfide can be a fuel or a food for other microbes which eat that particular chemical. So we have examples of both of these on Earth in regions where there's no sunlight. They are people on the surface, and the fuel is all the fuel of all these systems is one of their nitrogen. We call these extremophiles. And here's an example of towers of limestone that are built by archaea and bacteria in just off of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. These are about 200 feet high and beautiful. It's called the Lost City Formation. And we know that in these towers there are both these profound joints and profound channels that are putting out these gases that come up and blow. Well, okay. So this is just to show you that the serious biologists in the U.S. and elsewhere are actually looking at these life forms in deep springs, hot springs in Idaho. This is a mighty hot spring. They're seeing these unusual archaea that live there, and as they say, they're living on inorganic carbon, not something that's produced from sunlight or the organic residue of living creatures, but rather the inorganic carbonate and labeling. Here's a picture of the exploration of these gold mines for microbes. This is the team from Princeton that was led by Tullis Anstott. And here's a scientist actually working on one of these valves that basically is capped off the hot water that's coming out of these drifts that are drilled into the wall of the mine. Keep in mind, these folks are down at a depth of 3 kilometers. The temperature is 120 Fahrenheit. You know, this is not exactly a friendly environment, and the pressure in this water jet is about 5 bars, 5 times of its atmosphere. So it's coming out. If you stand in front of that, you're going to be injured. Well, anyway, in that water, they filter this and isolate this particular microbe, and its DNA has now been sequenced and published in Science. So turns out it's got a DNA string that's actually kind of like an oval. What's unique about it is that it has in it all of the functional groups to be a self-contained ecosystem. Really unusual, because normally an ecosystem depends on the symbiosis of many different life forms. Prosper. Right here in this room, you know, we couldn't exist if we didn't have an ecosystem which helps us produce food for us. It changes our waste gases back to oxygen and so forth and so on. So, this is really unusual to find a single entity ecosystem, but this one seems to be it. It's called the sulfurutis, meaning it basically modifies the sulfates. Audax viantor, and Audax viantor means bold traveler in Latin. Mm-hmm. So these guys, the discoverers, named this after the sign in the volcanic lava tube that was being traversed by the travelers in Jules Verne novel, Voyage to the Center of the Earth. I see some people nodding here who have read that book. And if you haven't read it, it's kind of fun. So this new microbe is named after Jules Verne's sign. So on the Tree of Life, this is where they are. This is, of course, all the eukaryotes. These are all plants and animals, all everything that moves on the earth. Think of as a plant or animal or shellfish and whatnot. We live right there. That's us, almost. The bacteria are here in this family, the domain, and the archaeal domain is over here. And near the root of the Tree of Life, at least the universal common ancestor, these are all extremophiles that were life forms that live in acidic environments or hypothermal and hot environments or cold environments and so on. Key point is that we now see that both the bacterium and these archaea life forms could survive on Mars quite happily. So let's ask then, well, what's the take-home message? This is what we think might be happening. This sketch shows the cutaway of the region of Mars, which was originally sealed by ice floods, such as that. In the first case, looks at the production from geochemical interaction of hot rock with water and CO2. The second case imagines that these are microbes living in that region called permafrost and releasing their gases into the atmosphere. Okay, so let's wrap up and talk about some of the issues that we are attempting to resolve today. First, we don't really know that biology is at work. Secondly, we don't really know when the methane was produced, but it was stored for a very long time, a big release now. So that is an issue then. Is it recent or is it ancient? How is it produced, by biology or not biology? And here are the several mechanisms that I discussed with you. How is it released? In this mechanism or by a different one in which the hydrates are destabilized, the pressure is released over the stored hydrates within those zones that are accessed by the vaporizing pores. Another question is, how is it destroyed? It seems to be destroyed much more rapidly than simple photochemistry in the atmosphere. This is an active area of research right now. And just 3 months ago, a group from Kennedy and the University of Central Florida published a paper demonstrating that this could, in fact, be destroyed rapidly by the interaction of ultraviolet light with mineral grains on Mars. So there's a cottage industry going on right now where people at many different institutions are trying to understand the different aspects and implications of this discovery. And finally, these things are several of the other perforates of strong family strong oxidants that were discovered by the Phoenix Polar. Okay, so, and finally, the recharge mechanism, right? And we don't know whether it's being released annually on Mars, but if it is, it means it has to be recharged somehow. And so biology could recharge it, and release it again the following year. Or it could be that it's being produced chemically and being recharged and released again. So that is an issue that has to be addressed. And some of these things we hope are going to be addressed by the Mars Science Laboratory Curiosity next year. Now the astronomers, however, have not been idle since 2003. Our group had a major campaign with the world's principal infrared observatories in a period from August of 2009 through June of 2010. And I realize that this doesn't sound too impressive to you. In addition to the 23 observing runs that we were awarded at these observatories, we also won another 6 or 7 to look at the water cycle and so on. And so this represents 500,000 new spectra. We've actually had to redo all of our analysis software, all of the IEL routines, as they're called, to process these data in a reasonable time. I'm happy to say that we've now done the production processing for all those data. We're now in the process of science extraction. So we're looking now for up to 10 different trace gases. I hope that you'll learn something about that in the next year as to what we've learned. And I think I'll leave it at that. These are some other things. Leave this final thought. These are the things we've talked about. We started with this knowledge. We want to know whether there was a second independent genesis of life, because it has fundamental implications for life as a general theme throughout the universe. We find second genesis here. And then I talked about terrestrial analogs and some of the questions and issues that were raised by the microscope. So thanks a lot for your attention. For sticking